And welcome to Catholic Charities' inaugural town hall in response to the COVID-19 pandemic in New York City and Lower Hudson Valley. Please join me in watching this inspirational public service announcement, which, by the way, you can also find on YouTube.
Catholic Charities workers, you wear no distinctive uniforms, no scrubs, no stethoscopes, no badges. You wear the same clothes as your neighbors. Our color, race, ethnicity, is as diverse as those we serve. Dedicated workers like you bring professionalism and compassion that literally is saving lives.
I'm ready to clap. I hope you all are as well. Hello, I'm Maria Morris, and I'm a member of the Board of Trustees of Catholic Charity. And I'm very honored to be your moderator today on this briefing. Monsignor, could you get us started with an opening prayer?
Why don't we just bow our heads and call to mind that we are in God's presence wherever we are. Almighty God, there is so much that we want to pray for. We give you thanks that in many parts of our country, the COVID-19 pandemic is on the wane, but Almighty God, we know in other places it is still very potent. So protect all your people throughout this nation and throughout the world. On this particular day when we gather for this Catholic Charities Town Hall, we know that our nation is in turmoil again. Not from this public health pandemic, but from the pain and the killing of George Floyd, whose memorial today is being held in many parts of this country. Bless us, God, with the ability to deal with the hurt, the pain, and the sinfulness that we bring to a number of situations. Help us to deal with the inequity that is still too much part of your world. Help us to deal with the fact that too many of us treat people differently and we dare say condescendingly and inferiorly because their race, their ethnicity is different than ours. Help us to continue that work of Catholic Charities of providing greater opportunity for every person made in your image and likeness. Almighty God, and we do give you thanks for the generous people, our donors, who make the work of providing help and creating hope possible. Please watch over them and their families. We give you thanks for their generosity and their faithfulness. And finally, Almighty God, there are so many thousands whom this day our Catholic Charities programs and agencies will assist. Keep them safe. Enable them to live in dignity. And all we ask all this in the name of Jesus, who is Lord forever and ever. Amen.
Marion, would you like to give us some of the logistics?
Sure thing, Maria. Hi, everyone. So we have several of you joining us by video today, and some of you joining by phone. We are in a webinar view for Zoom, so we can't see any of you, but very happy that you're with us. If you're joining us by phone and you have a question during the course of the webinar, please email that question to development@catholiccharitiesny.org. Again, that's development@catholiccharitiesny.org. And if you're joining us by video, on your screen, you'll see a Q&A button, little icon there. So you can type in your question and we'll be monitoring that during the course of the webinar. We'll try to get to every question, but if we don't, we'll certainly get back to you after this webinar. Thanks a lot, Maria.
But on the behalf of the Board of Trustees, I just want to thank you and join Monsignor in thanking you for your generosity to Catholic Charities. we are convening on such a critical time for our city and our country. And we all thought that dialogues like these were really important. Number one, to stay up to date on what we're doing together, but also to have a dialogue and be able to ask questions of each other that are important in this great work that Catholic Charities does. So we're really appreciative to have Monsignor with us today. And Monsignor, the floor is yours.
Maria, thank you so much. And I know that those of you who have joined us, many of you are working as hard as you usually work, even though in a very, very different way. Most are, or many are working remotely, and probably at some point, we all have gotten a little tired of Zoom. And so that you've chosen to join us this afternoon, I really, really appreciate. The other thing I will just mention to begin, as you can tell, we're in the phase of having been closed down. I am not posing as Santa Claus today, although a number of people have suggested that my beard is getting long enough that I could be Santa Claus. So, but it, you know, I wanna say thank you for you for joining us. And I just am really, really grateful for the opportunity to share with you some of the work that your donations and your generosity, along with many other people, has enabled Catholic Charities to do in an intensified way in the past 2 months or so. And so the right place to begin is to realize what the people in Rhinebeck, New York, put up right outside one of our agencies. Aster, you can see the sign there that says Aster. And you can see the sign that's put up, Heroes at Work. And that is what our Catholic Charities workers and volunteers have been doing for the past 2 months. Now, I don't mean by any means to pretend they're not heroes at other times, but heroes are those who in times of great crises and oftentimes at danger to themselves engage in incredible acts of service and help to their neighbors. So when I talk about our workers and our volunteers, I talk about them persevering. So the people at Aster, where that sign is in front of, are people who have residences for some very emotionally challenged young people, children. Those workers could not work remotely. They had to be there day in and day out in order to provide the care for those children who have great emotional challenges. And you can imagine the dangers to those challenges in this stressful time. I am so, so happy to say that as Aster, an agency of our Catholic Charities Federation, we were able, when they were in incredibly short demand, to be able to provide them with protective equipment, PPE, when it was almost unavailable because of the extraordinary creativity, dedication of our Catholic Charities Agency Relations Department, we kind of scrounged around and found equipment that we could share with our Federation of Agencies. Aster was one of those agencies that had to have its workers in close proximity to the people needing help. We were able to make that work safer and more secure for those workers. So that applies to everybody. Our workers, our volunteers, they persevered and expanded services. What you will see on the next slide is one of the main areas that we concentrated on. And you have probably picked up in the news that there is a tremendous amount of food insecurity, a lot of hungry people who are not able now to get food. Let me give you one example, which we probably don't even think about, okay? There are 1 million kids in the New York City public schools. For the majority of them, their two main meals a day are provided at schools. They have 180-day required curriculum. So for half the year, two meals for a million kids were provided at school as the ordinary course of affairs. Probably didn't even reflect on it much. So now you have a million kids who are not getting meals each day in New York City alone. Now, there have been some things that have gone on that have tried to supplement that, and a lot of people have stepped up to the plate. But I will tell you, nobody has stepped up to the plate more than our Catholic Charities Feeding Our Neighbor programs. We have done, in the past 2 months, close to 60 pop-up and expanded pantries in New York City and in the Hudson Valley. I myself personally have been in Washington Heights and Inwood. I've been in the South Bronx. I was up in Brewster, New York. Tomorrow I am intending to go to Kingsbridge. Next Friday I will go to Peekskill, New York. But throughout the area, the metropolitan area, probably 60 or so pop-up pantries that has provided over 10,000 bags of groceries to families in need, which is well over 100,000 meals. That's, quite frankly, what we've been able to do at Catholic Charities, and we're going to continue that for the next number of months as this crisis of financial insecurity, loss of jobs, continues. And with that, I'd like for us to look at what we've done in terms of financial assistance. You know, it's pretty simple. Why do people sometimes not have the necessities that they need? They don't have the money to buy them. It's not complicated. Maybe the reasons why they don't have sufficient jobs and the rest of it is complicated. But what families without jobs need, who've lost wages, they need financial assistance. So, through generous donors, already, Catholic Charities has been able to provide more than $2 million of financial assistance to people throughout New York City. And in the next couple of weeks, we'll expand that to the Hudson Valley and we'll continue the work in New York City. Through this program, again, relatively modest, but we've provided $500 gift debit cards to be used. In the image, in the photo you have in front of us, it was last Saturday, actually 10 days ago, that I was out with Cardinal Dolan on the North Shore of Staten Island. And he himself distributed some of that financial assistance to families who are on that North Shore. The photo on the left is the partnership that we did with schools and reached out to some of the poor school families in our parochial schools. And that distribution of gift cards is in the Bronx. So with our partnership with the schools and the parishes, we've been able to reach almost every community in New York City. And that financial assistance, we're going to be continuing that. Ultimately, we're just not going to be able to do any more of it. But this is an immediate help that we will have provided to probably close to 6,000 individuals or households in that financial distribution. But it's more than about financial assistance. On Staten Island last Saturday or 10 days ago, we also visited some of the residences where some adults with severe developmental disabilities live. And again, they can't go home. Let me change that. They are home. we provide homes for hundreds of adults with developmental disabilities. What are we going to do in a pandemic? What are we going to do with social distancing? We're going to throw them out on the street and say, sorry, it's not safe. You got to go out on the street. All workers can't come in. No, no. All workers have to be there. And they're there. Yes, we cut staff a bit. So we did everything. We did the PPE. We did everything we could. But, and we took good care of those individuals. But tragically, in the home you're actually looking at, we lost two. We lost two of our adults. They passed away from corona virus, from COVID-19. And we probably had a dozen staff in those residences who got sick, who came down with the virus. But that's what Catholic Charities does. We don't have a choice. That's our mission. That's what we've got to keep doing. Now, fortunately, we were able to provide a little bit of whatever you want to call it, incentive, hazard pay to those staff to recognize that. But I told this story before and I'm going to tell it again. I called one of the staff members who had COVID-19 and pretty bad case. He was actually in Jacoby Hospital in the Bronx. He got out. He had another setback. I called him on the phone and he was really on the way to mend. He was doing a lot better. So I got to the end of the conversation, which let me tell you, he was incredibly calm, a lot calmer than I would have been. The end of the conversation, he said, you know, I got to get better quickly because those people need us. I got to get back to work now. Well, he is a model of thousands of Catholic Charity staff who basically have been in perilous situations in residences like this or in our food pantries. But that's not all that we do. And if we look at what we're doing in Washington Heights and what we're doing in particularly the hybrid section of the Bronx, you'll see what one of our programs like Alianza is doing. And what they have done, quite frankly, is they've continued and they've pivoted. So Alianza provides in school, out of school, after school, summer programs for over 2,000 young people. Well, what do? The schools are closed. Well, they moved over to enrichment centers. And here's the frustration about working in a pandemic. They moved over to the enrichment center to take care of kids who needed daycare because their parents were essential workers. Well, they were there all set to work. And as you might understand, parents were not so enthused about sending their kids to a new experience with people they didn't know. So those enrichment centers, while they were up and running and our staff had pivoted to do the work, there wasn't a lot of demand. So what did they do then? They called every week the kids and the families who they weren't seeing. In a particular week, I know they made 2,000 calls to families. They didn't do all of them the next week. And you know what? A couple of families called them and said, hey, what happened? How come you didn't give us a call? The connections that our workers make with the people they help, they're not statistics. It really is. And I say this even in this social distancing world, it really is up close and personal. What that team has also done in Washington Heights is, if you look at the photo on the right-hand side, what you'll see is, because they didn't have a lot to do in schools, they then turned to bagging food and providing groceries for the families whose kids weren't getting those two meals every day in school. They probably have done themselves at least 10 of those pop-up pantries. I'm lamenting a little bit. I'm not going to go to a Yankee game this year, but last Friday in the rain was up with those kids, those young, actually, everybody's a kid these days to me, but that those staff there in their 20s and their 30s in the rain had bagged food, and right up from Yankee Stadium in Highbridge were giving them out to families that were in need. And so they have done an incredible amount. Let me just say something which is on everybody's mind right now. The unrest, the turmoil in the reverberations after the killing of George Floyd. Some of our neighborhoods are a little bit like tinder blocks, because the neighborhoods we're in are the neighborhoods who feel the impact so tremendously. They're the neighborhoods that this coronavirus has really, really hit the hardest. And it's those same communities where, sadly, tragically, there are the divisive tensions too often between the police and community members. Well, where our Alianza programs are, that's where those tensions are. And that photo of the three young people on the left, if you look over the leftmost corner there, I believe you'll see one of the precincts. Our Alianza people for decades have been building relationships between youth and police in those communities. They have been walking the streets in the past 3-4 nights, talking to young people, encouraging peaceful protests, discouraging any of those actions of looting, of violence, destruction against persons, against things which destroy kind of the message of peaceful protest. But only because those Alianza staff have credibility in those communities and daily are working with young people can they make that creative and that important contribution to those problems. Let me go on to one additional factor that is absolutely part of so much of what we do. I mentioned the Alianza people calling up, but as you can see in the slide there, one of our workers, she's on some type of group Zoom call with people whom she has been in contact with. It's reinforcement, it's contact, it's support, it's counseling, but so many of our workers now with laptops, iPads, Chromebooks, and those technologies that I don't even know about are able to maintain contact with the people who used to come into the office, who used to be sitting at a desk next to them. So many of our staff are in their own homes, their own apartments, doing the work from there. That's where they're answering our helplines and our hotlines to provide help, connect people with the resources that are needed. You know, is it as good as being in front of somebody? You know, probably not. But you know, it's interesting. In some of the stuff that we're doing, we're finding it's a little bit easier for people to make Zoom appointments than to get on the subway in the Northeast Bronx, take the subway down to Lower Manhattan. So there's some of these things that it's probably even a little better that we're able to reach more people more efficiently in this. So we're gonna have to look at that after we're on the other side of this to figure out how that impacts the work that that we're doing. And I can say more about that in the questions and answers if anybody cares to learn more about it. This is, again, the slide that is in front of you is of our immigration center down in Lower Manhattan on Maiden Lane. Now, I know that center very well. On a regular day, there'd be over 100 staff. Actually, today, a Thursday, right where you see almost nobody, there would be over 100 new Americans, immigrants, parents, children, waiting to be served by our staff. Well, since I think it was March 15th or 16th, can't do it. So that office is closed. However, because a lot of those people are not eligible for some of the financial assistance, our immigration staff registered over 990 individuals for special cash assistance that we had available and arranged over the course of 2 weeks for socially distanced appointments in which we also provided a bag of groceries, as you can see in the corner there, so that we could provide that cash assistance. Usually we're providing legal assistance. Usually we're helping people to get work authorization. Usually we're teaching them English. We're helping them to improve their immigration status. But we're doing some of that remotely, but we pivoted and made sure they got some financial assistance and they got a bag of groceries in order to make sure that they could do it. You know, the other group of immigrants that we really work with are day laborers. These are the guys, for the most part, a couple of women, but the reality is mostly guys who line up on the corners, they call paradas, stops, where they line up for work. Landscaping, construction, those are the main jobs that they do. they're still lining up. Fewer of them, we're trying to encourage them to be socially distant, but far fewer of them are getting picked up as you might imagine. But we continue to work with them. And again, we have provided some financial assistance to them. I'm going to end my presentation by sharing with you a video. And the video to me that I'm sharing with you, and blame me if you don't like it, because I was the one who insisted that we do it. If you do like it, it was the other staff who did it. But if you don't, blame me. But here's why I want you to see it. It's a little bit unusual. And when you think of a social service agency, maybe you think of food distribution, maybe you think of counseling, maybe you think of rental assistance. But Catholic Charities is different, I'm sorry. We do all of that, but we're really personal. And I gotta tell you, if anybody doesn't think that immigrants have bought into the American dream and wanna be Americans, all I want you to do is to get them to watch this 1 minute and 51 second video, which I call the Immigrant Pizza Video. Let's watch it.
Thank you for helping the Bronx Day Laborers. If we respect health protocols, we can help each other without unnecessary risks. Together, we will come out of this crisis. Bronx Day Labor Program received a generous donation of slices of pizza and drinks to take to the sites, or paradas, where the day laborers from our program meet. To help as volunteers, first thing is to be aware of health protocols. Please use your mask, keep your hands clean at all times with sanitizing gel, and never forget social distancing. At this moment, this is our defense against coronavirus, and if we use them with discipline, they are effective against getting infected or infecting others. There is no reason to get into physical contact or to break health protocols. The first duty of the volunteers is to organize workers into a line, respecting the 6 feet between each person. This is how we've been working. All the volunteers help to organize a line of people 6 feet apart. Volunteer number one walks along the line giving plates and napkins. Volunteer number two gives beverages. Volunteer number 3 holds the pizza boxes while volunteer number 4 cuts slices and gives them to the people on the line. You can create your own strategy as long as we respect health protocols. The pizzas are to be picked up at 11 a.m., 11 in the morning, on 149 East 149th Street in the Bronx. The pizza place is called Mr. Pizza. It's on the opposite side of Hostos Community College. After picking up the pizzas, you can deliver them to any of the following paradas or sites. Parada 138. The address is 281 Bruckner Boulevard. Parada Home Depot, Wisto. This is 2560 Bruckner Boulevard. Parada Westchester. Parada Westchester is located in 91 Westchester Square. It's a BP gas station. Parada 180. Parada 180 is located in 3rd Avenue and 180th Street. It's in a parking lot right in front of a hardware store. And the parada at Home Depot Gun Hill, which is located at 1806 East Gun Hill. For any questions, call me. My name is Juan Pablo, 929-237-3262, or call Emmanuel at 646-836-0491. Thank you.
It's amazing to see just how you've used the education approach and yet really helping people get both food and the ability to work. It really is very inspiring. I'd like to move on now to what I consider the best part of this, which is the Q&A. First of all, thank you. It's so hard to put into words all the amazing work that you and the teams of Catholic Charities do, but I think a picture says 1,000 words. And we have a few questions that have come in from people on the phone, specifically around a few of the programs. So I'd like to start there. On Aster, could you just give us a little feel for the range of the children's ages and how did the children kind of come to be there?
Okay, so Aster Services is about a 50-60-year-old Catholic Charities agency that is operating primarily in Dutchess County, some work in Orange County, and some significant work in the Bronx. They have stayed close to the knitting in focusing on children's mental health. That is their focus. And in fact, they are accredited by the Joint Commission on Health and Hospital Organizations as meeting those very, very rigorous standards for quality. Their programs are both residential, as the sign we saw in the beginning was. There is also a school there where kids who really couldn't function in a regular classroom are educated. And then there is also another school in the Bronx which provides similar types of classes that are there. But they also do a tremendous amount of community-based counseling. And so they do counseling of children who have emotional challenges and need counseling and therapy. The program that they have undertaken, particularly in the Bronx, in the past 3 years, has to go into the public schools. And they are now, I believe, in more than 30, 35 public schools in the Bronx, where they bring that counseling and that therapy into those public schools so the kids don't lose as much academic time. And basically, the whole focus of the counseling is so that those kids can succeed in school, so that their emotional challenges do not get in the way of their academic success. And those are the major programs that Aster Services does.
You know, you mentioned tangentially that there's probably some government funding for this kind of a program. What are you thinking about in terms of government funding going forward, and how will some of our agencies kind of flex in terms of services being provided? What's the importance of the philanthropy that we all do as an example?
Marie, you're completely on target. We could not do what we do. An agency like Aster is overwhelmingly funded through its partnership with government. We're worried. I pray. We all know that, you know, governments can't spend money they don't have, and the downturn of businesses and tax revenue. The people on the call don't need an economics lesson from me, but just be aware that we are monitoring that that tremendously. And you know what goes on in Washington and Albany and New York City, it's all interaction. So I don't know. What I do know is the belts will be tightened. Just how much tighter we have to take them in, will we have to figure it out. But I would say, not merely because of the cutbacks, although important. That's why our donors, our private philanthropy is so important. And I think it's what makes Catholic Charities special, because of particularly the donors to our COVID emergency funds. As soon as we needed to respond, we made a commitment to doing certain things. Yes, now, after a month or two, has government stepped up and said, hey, we want to give you some money for food. We want to give you money from, but our staff was able to say, and I was able to say to our staff, do the work, do what needs to be done, because we knew we had the financial backing. Quite frankly, it starts with our board, and our board super stepped up to the plate. And so many of you who are on this call stepped up to the plate. You know, we're going to need that more than ever. And let me just say one thing, which is a little bit broader. It's impossible for private philanthropy to completely take the place of government funding. That's just not realistic, which is why we advocate so strongly about the quality of our programs with government, their effectiveness, their efficiency, so that it's a good use of tax dollars to fund the work we do. So government is absolutely essential, but more and more private philanthropy is even more successful. I'm on calls with human service organizations that do a really good job, but they may not make it because they don't have the base of generous, good, caring donors that can help us deal with a lot of the volatility that is part of the world right now.
Yeah, I have to say, I've been so impressed. I'm on the agency committee and the development committee, as you know, and I've been so impressed with the agency committee's ability to really understand, first of all, be engaged with the agency so directly and really be there immediately and have the flexibility to do it. So thank you. I really appreciate hearing that. A second question came in with regard to the pop-up pantries. Any plans for Newburgh, Beacon, and Poughkeepsie?
We do stuff in the Hudson Valley. So I believe, I don't have the schedule in front of me, but to be perfectly honest, we have been able to respond to almost every place where there has been a request. There's so much need that what we've done is two things. We've expanded what we've been doing already. And in some of the funding we've given some additional funding to Catholic Charities of Dutchess County to expand what they do in Poughkeepsie. We've given some additional funds to Orange County to do additional work in Newburgh. But I can't, where was, oh, in Beacon. And Beacon, which is in Dutchess County, Catholic Charities of Dutchess County, can. But I say to everybody when I'm on these calls, if we're missing a need and we should be someplace else, reach out. And if we can do it, we will do it.
Yeah, and I would just say too, to Lewis who sent in the question, let us know if you have a specific question or a specific need, because the staff of Catholic Charities is going to be going back with written answers if we haven't answered them on this call. So thank you for that. Just talk a little bit, Monsignor, about the changes you've had to make with your staffs. You know, kind of how did you so quickly and agilely move into this digital environment? And what does it mean for us? Like, how are we going to be able to help going forward to make sure that you can do what you need to do again in my behalf of the agencies?
Well, Maria, I'm not quite sure this is the right management answer, but I think the answer is a lot of luck, a lot of prayer, a lot of crossing our fingers, but on the basis of incredibly solid work that had been done for years, an incredibly dedicated, intelligent, and creative managers who saw this as another crisis, as we did after the World Trade Center attack of 9/11, as we did after the Great Recession of 2008, as we did after Superstorm Sandy. You know, some of us have said, you know, maybe this is our last emergency, but we've had staff who have been dedicated to the work of Catholic Charities for long enough that we are able to be nimble and to be flexible. I also say that, and I want to thank the board, our Catholic Charities board, about 2 years ago, when we were trying to scrimp together every single dollar for programs and services, they said, hey, stop. You got to build up your IT capacity. You just can't overdo it. So we built up, granted, very, very small, but I don't think we got a more dedicated small team of IT people than Michael San, who's kind of putting together the Zoom thing, Hafez, who has basically worked incredible hours just booting, rebooting, loading, unloading laptops, remote computers, so that very, very quickly we were able to get in the hands of our staff the tools they needed to be able to work remotely. So it was basically great, experienced, talented, resourceful staff who on a day-to-day basis are meeting individual crises, who came together as a team to figure out how we become nimble in this community-wide crisis.
And I'll tell you, just they haven't missed a beat, which is so impressive. So thank you for your leadership and all of that. Maybe the last question that I'd ask is, you know, given everything that you've talked about and given the reverberation after the killing of George Floyd, do you see any changes or priorities that Catholic Charities needs to take on in addition to just what we do every day?
I do, Maria, and this is going to require us to be very, very committed, very prudent, but not be afraid to take some risks. And because as we've reflected upon the turmoil going on in our nation and in our city, some of it absolutely disgraceful, but yet most of it pointing out things that daily we experience in the neighborhoods and communities where we work. We experience the fact that, you know, too often in this country and in our city, depending on the color of your skin, you have either more or less opportunities. Depending on that, you have access to healthcare, you have access to schools, etc. And maybe we don't say this every day, but so many of our programs are trying to deal with that in making sure that those who have less opportunities have more opportunities. Those who face inequities and inequalities, that they get our first attention in the resources and needs that we have. And so, Maria, when you say this, I just think we have to be more explicit in focusing on that. And also, I think we have to listen to the voices of our staff, not merely old white men like me, but our staff in their 20s, in their 30s, who are living in these communities, and we have to learn from them. We have to make the commitment as an organization to be even more urgent about dealing with inequities in those whom we serve, the lack of opportunities. But in figuring out how we do that, we got to learn from so many people. We don't know the answers. We got to learn from them. We have to partner with so many. Let me just end that with something I learned the other day. That slide about the Alianza kids. Now that Alianza program, I said this year, is dealing with 2,500 young people. Well, it's been in existence for decades, okay? What I learned when I was talking to them the other day, that community-based organization in one of the poorer neighborhoods of New York City, a neighborhood which knows a lot of inequality, and actually my first assignment as a priest was in that community, so I know it a little bit better than others. But in that community, that Alianza program has produced now 50 New York City police officers.
Oh, wow.
So that there is that connection that's there. We just now have to be more intentional on figuring out how we can pay attention to it to do an even more urgent part in dealing with the inequities and creating greater opportunities.
So maybe we can have a town hall in the future once you've done more of your research and connection and partnership to talk about kind of next steps here.
I think that's true. And when we have the next town hall, I want some of those people speaking, and I'm just going to eat my socially distanced pizza.
No, that sounds good to me. I just want to, first of all, thank everyone for taking the time. Thank people for sending in questions ahead and the questions we got on the call. And I just want to just reiterate something that Monsignor said, which is Catholic Charities could not do this without all of you. And it just means so much to me personally and to the entire team that you all took the time during this crazy, crazy time of year to come out and be part of this. Because at the end of the day, we're doing this together and we're a community. So I say thank you. And I want to close by having Monsignor close for us. And then at the end of Monsignor's comments, we'll be done with our first town hall. So thank you so much.
Maria, may I end as we kind of began with a little bit of prayer and a blessing?
Sure.
Almighty God, we give you thanks and we ask you a blessing on those who make the work of Catholic Charities possible. We give you thanks for their generosity, their commitment. We give you thanks for their trust in our ability to steward well their hard-earned resources that we use on behalf of those who are poorest and most vulnerable in our neighborhoods. So we give you thanks for their goodness, the goodness of our staff and our volunteers. And as we end, Almighty God, we ask your blessings upon them, and we ask your blessings upon our city and upon our nation and upon our world through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Amen. Thank you for joining us.